How many of us here have felt the sting of sin? Should be everybody, right? I know that some of us here have experienced prison where you have four walls, a ceiling, bars in front of you. I've never experienced that type of prison. Some sin leads to that kind of prison. But all sin leads to a prison within yourself, because you cannot break out of that prison without the Lord Jesus. Romans 3:23 says, yeah, just turn the volume down there, it's on top. Okay, that should do it. It says, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And then Romans 6:23 reads, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. What this is saying is there isn't anybody that's not sinned. Anybody that has never sinned, except for one person, and that person is Jesus Christ. But we've all felt the sting of sin, and we've all paid the price. We actually earned our way to hell because we were sinners. Does anybody here? Well, let me see a show of hands. How many saints do we have here? Only one, two, three, four. If you're saved, you're a saint. Okay. You are no longer a sinner. Because why? Because Jesus has not only covered your sins with his blood, he has taken them away. He has made you a new man, or new woman, if the case is. But, I'll tell the ladies, if I can be a bride of Christ, you can be a son of God. The word sin used in the Bible, particularly in the Greek, means to miss the mark. I can use the analogy of, say, a target and shooting an arrow at the target. But your target is only that big, okay? If you tried to hit a target that big 100 yards away, you're probably going to miss it, unless you're really good, okay? But you only have to miss the mark by that much. And you've lost the prize. Every sin we commit is missing the mark. And in James 1, it says that if you sin on one count of the law, you have violated the entire law. How many commandments are there? Anybody know? KB? Well, let's go back a little bit further. There are actually 613 laws, commandments. We might be able to name 10 of them. Okay? There were not just the first 10, but there were laws concerning relationships. There were laws concerning food and what the Jews could eat, what they could not eat, and they were very detailed. So can anybody recite all 10 commandments, all of the first 10 commandments? Do you know that it was back in 63 that prayer was taken out of the public schools because one person complained? That's pathetic. It wasn't long after that that the Ten Commandments were taken out of public schools. Why? Because a judge said the kids might obey them. Are you kidding me? Thou shalt not kill. You don't want the kids to obey that commandment? Thou shalt not steal? And then eight others that we can think of. And those are the only the first 10 that are emphasized in the church today. But that's legalism, to say that you have to obey the law in order to be saved. Obedience to the law is self-righteousness. I think I'm getting off on a tangent here. That first part, and that we're talking about the content on page 28 in your books, if you're not there already. There are a number of kinds of sins. The Bible gives several names for different types of sins: iniquity, transgression. I can't think of the other one. But basically, they come under two categories: sins of commission and sins of omission. A sin of commission would be a violation of, say, the Ten Commandments, stealing or killing or one of those, even taking the Lord's name in vain. But a sin of omission is the good that you know to do and do not do it. Okay. The word death in the New Testament, it's actually made up of two Greek words. But it basically means death. But a part of that means that it can be separation. In Genesis 2:16 and 17, and I don't think that's in the book, Jonathan, but if you want to bring it up, it says, "And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest of it, thou shalt surely die." If the last part of that last sentence was to be translated literally, it would read like this: "For in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt die. It uses the Greek word or Hebrew word for death two times. And when a word in scripture is repeated immediately, it's emphasizing that word. But it's also a metaphor for the fact that we would die spiritually when we're born, and we would die physically. And I think Adam and Eve understood that. If we look at item B here on page 28, it says, sin is addictive and destructive. In Titus 3:3, "At one time we too were foolish, disobedient, deceived, and enslaved by all kinds of passions and pleasures. We lived in malice and envy, being hated and hating one another. What really is sin? It's showing malice or hatred towards your neighbor. Because all sin is a violation of love, basically. Right? When we violate one of those first 10 commandments, we are actually hating our neighbor. What are the two greatest commandments? I think KB knows what they are. The greatest commandments? Love your neighbor as you love yourself. Every sin is a violation against our neighbor. 2 Peter 2:19 says, man is a slave to whatever has mastered him. How many tried to break out of the direction they were going before they met Christ? You tried to break out of that direction all by yourself, didn't you? Didn't work. Never worked. Yeah. No matter what you did, no matter how hard you tried, you couldn't break the cycle. And sometimes even after becoming a born-again believer, we remain in that cycle because it has become so familiar with us. Okay. And I believe the problem is not that Jesus is not there with you. It's that we have not got a full revelation of God's love for us. Because everything that God did was out of love. John 3:16, everybody knows that scripture, right? Even the world knows that scripture, but they don't believe it. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth on him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. One of the problems with a lot of preachers that are preaching on that scripture is they talk about our sins being forgiven, but what they don't talk about is the everlasting life that comes with it. Okay. When we are saved, not only are our sins covered, wiped away, God has thrown every single one of them into the sea of forgetfulness. He's cast every one of our sins as far as the east is from the west. And he has given us eternal life here and now. We don't have to wait until we die. We can have that life now. That's something that Kazuko and I didn't really understand for many years, because it wasn't being preached from the pulpit. We heard bits and pieces, but it was never actually put together for us. Number two here on page 28, it said, sin is pleasure for a moment, in consequences for a lifetime. I added a couple of words here. Sin is pleasure for a moment, and consequences can be for a lifetime. They don't have to be. Okay. Some sin might be consequences for a lifetime. For example, if we were condemned to prison for the rest of our lives. That's consequences for a lifetime. There's a couple of other phrases here that I either crossed out a word or added a word to. 2A in the book says, Christians live for heaven and the future, while unbelievers live for the present and now. The present and now, that sounds like the same thing to me. So what I did was, unbelievers live for the world and now. We live for the things of the world as unbelievers because we don't know how to live in the fullness of who we are in Christ. The next comment here says, magnify the consequences. When tempted, don't underestimate the consequences of sin. The consequences will always be worse than you think. Instead, when tempted, magnify the consequences. I would say, don't do that. I'd say, magnify the Lord when you are tempted. If we magnify the Lord, we won't even think about the temptation. On the next page, and I'm not going to try to blast through all of this because there is a lot of content here. But I hope I can hit on some high points. On page 29 is what they refer to the stages of sin. The battle for your soul is up here. It's in your mind. Romans 12, 1 and 2. Go ahead and put that up, Jonathan. Romans 12, 1 and 2. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Okay? The battle is up here, between your ears, in that stuff we call the gray matter, okay? I can't remember which verse it is, but as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. That's in Proverbs, okay? The way we think is what we're going to act out. And I wrote down here, you won't act on in the flesh what you haven't carried out in your mind first. Excuse me, I got to take a cough drop. Keeps my mouth from drying up. Okay, let's put up James 1 there, Jonathan. When tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me, for God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone, but each one is tempted when by his own evil desire he is dragged away and enticed. Then after desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is full grown, gives birth to death. I think we've all experienced a little bit of death when we have sinned. Okay. as I mentioned before, death can mean separation. You feel, you actually feel in your spirit that separation, not only from God, but maybe from a loved one, or from a neighbor, or even children. Stage one, A, there is the battle of the mind, temptation enticed by evil desire or lust, as you see and desire the temptation. I'm thinking of chocolate. There is somebody in our office that is a chocolate fiend. It's not me, but I love chocolate. But I may see the chocolate on the table, and you know, look at it and turn away, as I don't want to be tempted by the chocolate. Okay. Temptation can be anything, really. Pastor Bob said that he smoked for a year after he got saved, and the Lord took that away eventually. But he said he was tempted for a couple of weeks to pick up a cigarette again. I've tried to smoke. I couldn't get past the burning in my lungs or the foul taste in my mouth, so I just never I went beyond that point. So there was that temptation to even try to get to smoke. My father smoked from the time he was 15 until he was 85. But he suffered some of the consequences of that habit before he died. And he lived another 6 years after that. One A there says, other versions of the Bible use the word lust instead of evil desire. Lust is an evil desire and a strong desire. Paul even used that the word covet, which in the Greek, covet and lust are the same thing. I can covet anything. I can covet a particular kind of car or money or anything, really. Fortunately, there are no kids here at this time, so. I can even covet sex. You know, we often use the word lust for that particular thing, but it's all the same thing. Okay, B on page 29, stage two is sinful action. Do you know that you don't actually have to act out anything for it to be sin? For instance, Jesus said, you've all heard, do not commit adultery. But I say to you that whoever looks after a woman to lust for her has already committed adultery with her in his heart. That goes for you ladies too. Not that you would lust after another woman, but there is a woman in my ministry class at Caris Bible College that gave a testimony that she was addicted to pornography. Okay. In the church, more than 50% of men are addicted to pornography. In the church. And I think the statistic for women is about 30%. That's way too high. It should be zero. But it's because we haven't got a full revelation of the love of God. Sin is full-grown when it comes out of the mind and into the action during a moment of temptation. But like I said, the sin can actually occur before the action takes place. But if you're continually thinking on a particular action, eventually you're going to carry the action out. I'm going to read out of Philippians 4. I wrote it down. It isn't Philippians 4. Sorry, would help to be in the right book. Starting in verse 6 of Philippians 4:6. Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication. With thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which passes understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Finally, my brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, and if there be any praise, think on these things. If we fill our minds with the Word of God, then the Word of God will sink into our hearts. But we have to meditate on those things. We have to continually speak them, continually think on them. We can't be in the Word for 10 minutes and then doing worldly stuff for 8 hours in order to keep the Word of God in our hearts. I guess most of us here work, but even if you don't work, you can take quite a bit of time to just sit and read one chapter of scripture and then meditate on that verse or those verses for even hours. But when we do that, the Lord is actually going to give us understanding of what we just read. Now you might read something and you go, I don't get it. I've done that many times. I don't get it. Lord, can you give me understanding? Well, of course he can. Lord, please give me understanding of what I just read. Meditate on the scripture. Pray in your prayer language. He'll give you the understanding of what you just read. I think most of you were not here when I spoke the first time. In IHOP Church, that was a year and a half ago. Maybe almost 2 years ago, maybe. I talked about the wedding at Cana, and the title of my message was Water to Wine. And it's really interesting, when you read something in Scripture, what you just read may not be the message. And it may not be exactly what you just read. I believe the Holy Spirit gave me three basic revelations just out of the wedding at Cana. And they were all different, but led to the same thing. Kazuko has given her testimony about healing just 2-3 weeks ago on her back. And when she prayed, the Lord gave her one word. And out of that one word came her healing. Amen. We sometimes hear prophets go on and on and on, and they don't say anything. But when the Holy Spirit speaks to you, every word that he says to you, whether it's one word or 10 words, is going to lead you to the healing that you need. Whether it's healing in your mind, healing in your heart, or healing in your body. An interesting definition of the word healing or salvation is actually that the same Greek word is used for both healing and salvation, sozo. And that word is an all-encompassing word that means to heal, to deliver, to save, to be made whole. Remember, the woman that had the infirmity that came up behind Jesus and touched his garment. What did Jesus say to her when she finally confessed that it was her that touched him? Woman, your faith has made you whole. And that's that same Greek word. Jesus came to make us whole. I'm not going to read the example there in page 29, because we now have children here. I'll let you take care of that, brother. On page 30, number 3, here is relational holiness. It's important that we understand that we are forgiven. All of your sins, past, present, and future, not only covered, but taken away, cast into the sea, as far as the east is from the west, and God does not hold those against you anymore. Romans 5:6-9. You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. And we were ungodly, all of us, before we came to Christ, weren't we? Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous man, though for a good man, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were yet sinners, or still sinners, Christ died for us. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? That's another thing that Jesus gave us. He saved us from God's wrath. We are not subject to God's wrath anymore because of what Christ did for us. Before Christ, every one of us deserved his wrath, and we all deserved death and hell. But God had mercy on every one of us. Not just the saved, but the unsaved also. He had mercy on the unsaved because Jesus died for everybody. It's not God's desire that anybody should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Right? Number three here under A on page 30 reads, past, present, and future sins are covered by the blood of Jesus. Interesting word used there. Interesting Greek word used there. Does everybody have a Strong's Concordance? Yes. Is there anybody that does not? Okay. I love the Strong's Concordance because it'll take that word in the English, give you the Greek word, and expand or expound on the meaning. A lot of times English words leave something to be desired, right? But it's interesting that a lot of the English language is taken from Latin and Greek. So how come we don't really know what the full meaning of some of the words we use is? Well, that Greek word is epikalypto. And it's made up of two Greek words. Epi, which is a preposition, is upon, on, at, by, before, on, at, over, against, across, against. And the second word is kalupto, which means to hide or to cover with a veil. But more specifically, it means to hinder the knowledge of a thing. When our sins were covered, Christ hid the knowledge of our sin from the Father. Wrote those down here. Isaiah 53:11, Jonathan. He shall see of the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. That's the word I was trying to remember before. Iniquities is another type of sin. And that word to bear means to take upon himself. He took our sins away from us, put him on himself, and took him to the cross. Jesus went to the cross to atone for our sins. Romans 5:11. And not only so, but we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we have now received the atonement. It's another interesting English word. You can separate the word into three parts. And if you when you do that, it says at one meant. And what it means in the Greek is to exchange. Christ exchanged God's righteousness for our sin. He took on our sin and gave us his righteousness. The prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Okay? If you're saved, you're righteous. It doesn't have the same meaning as we have here in the U.S., maybe in Europe too, put on that word righteous. It doesn't mean that I'm perfect in the things that I do. It just means that I am right with God, whether I sin or not. And we all still do sin, don't we? But we're not going to do certain things. You know, a simple sin might be if I got angry at my wife. Right? Or your kids. Yeah. Or even just ignored something the Holy Spirit is saying to me. Micah 7:19. Some of these are not in the book, so Jonathan's not quite ready. He will turn again. He will have compassion upon us. He will subdue our iniquities. And thou wilt cast all their sins into the depths of the sea. That's the sea of forgetfulness that I mentioned. And I think I'm going to have to end with B here. We become like Jesus. 1 Peter 1:14 through 16. As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance. And that's really all of us. When we're living in the world, we're living in ignorance of everything that's in this book. I could, even when I was an unbeliever, I probably could have quoted John 3:16. I could have even told you what the Ten Commandments were. But it didn't mean anything to me because it wasn't accompanied by faith in Christ. But just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, be holy because I am holy. This process of becoming holy is called sanctification. It's going to last a lifetime. You're not going to be totally sanctified until we go to be with the Lord. can continue to work on it. Right? Our spirit is saved. That's a given. Our minds have to be renewed, and our bodies eventually will return to dust, but God will raise us in newness of life with glorified bodies, right? Well, I don't want to go through that just yet. I'd like to stay here a little while longer. Mm-hmm. Maybe at least 30 years. Yeah, I'll be 101 at that time. All depends on me. This is a process lasting a lifetime that is finished in heaven. Becoming holy is a paradox. Let's read Hebrews 10:14. I'll just read it from there. For by one offering he has perfected forever them that are sanctified. If you're saved, you are perfected forever. Amen. We have that eternal life now. We are perfected forever. We're filled with the Holy Ghost. Like one preacher says, I am wall to wall Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. I am one third Holy Ghost, because he is joined with my spirit. Okay. Amen. Well, I'd like to go on, but Kazuko and I do have to get to our daughter's place, and it's going to take us about 30 minutes to tear down. So let's go ahead and pray. Thank you, Father, for this time. We thank you for the word that you have given us. We thank you for the revelation that you have given each one of us, and the grace that you have shown, the mercies you have shown to us this morning and each and every morning, for your mercies are new every morning. Pray, Lord, that each person here would go in the power and the strength of your spirit and think on these things that we've talked about, not only today, but the rest of their lives, the rest of our lives. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. If anybody here would like prayer, please come on up. And if anyone would like to help pray for them, come on up too.